وأقول في القرآن ما جاءت به آياته فهو الكريم المنزال. وأقول قال الله جل جلاله والمصطفى الهادي ولا أتأول.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد. إن شاء الله تعالى today I want to talk about some of the benefits and the فوائد in my journey to India. As you all, some of you might be aware of, I traveled to India and I had come back a week ago. And this journey was the best journey of my entire life. The benefits that I saw, the things that I came in contact with, this journey for me, I've never traveled a journey like it or close to it. Even my journey to Hajj wasn't as good as this one. And I saw so many things which I cannot, and I don't think I would be able to share everything of it. I wrote over 200 benefits, but I don't think I could go through all of them. So I'll choose, inshallah ta'ala, some of those fawaid and the benefits which I saw, inshallah ta'ala. The scholars, the Ahlul Ilm, the people of knowledge, they will talk about their rihalat, their journeys, their travels. They will do this. It's mashhur. For example, Al-Allamah Muhammad Al-Amin Al-Shanqiyatiyo, he wrote a book about his rihla ila baytillahi al-haram, his journey to the Kaaba. And in that book, he wrote so many benefits in it. He also wrote another book called Al-Rihlatu ila Ifriqiya. He's traveled to Africa. Al-Walati, rahimahullah, he has a journey in which he speaks about his traveling. Siddiq Hassan Khan, Al-Qinnuji, he also has a rihla to the Kaaba, benefits that he wrote in it. And the scholars, they say, إِن لَمْ تَكُونُوا مِثْلَهُمْ فَتَشَبَّهُوا إِنَّ التَّشَبُّهَ بِالْكِرَامِ فَلَاحُ. If you can't be like them, then copy them, imitate them. For verily, imitating the righteous people, it's a virtue itself. So what I did was this journey, I gathered together the things that I saw, the people I came into contact with, the advices that they gave me, the things which I saw as a benefit. The first, inshallah ta'ala, point is, why did I go to India and why this particular place? Al-Allama Sadiq Hassan Khan Al-Qinnawji, rahimahullah, he mentions in his kitab Al-Hitta fi dhikri al-sihahi sitta. He says, حَمَلَةُ الْعِلْمِ فِي الْإِسْلَامِ أَكْثَرُهُمُ الْعَجَمِ. The majority of the people who've carried this knowledge are not the Arabs. They're actually the foreigners. This knowledge, the majority of the people who've passed it on, who've gathered it, are actually not the Arabs. They are who? The non-Arabs. وَذَلِكَ مِنَ الْغَرِيبِ الْوَاقِعِ. And he said, this is a fascinating, strange thing in reality. لِأَنَّ عُلَمَاءِ الْمِلَّةِ الْإِسْلَامِيَّةِ فِي الْعُلُومِ الشَّرْعِيَّةِ وَالْعَقْلِيَّةِ أَكْثَرُهُمُ الْعَجَمِ إِلَّا فِي الْقَلِيلِ النَّادِرِ. Very little do you actually even find people who are Arabs who've become the first people in this particular field. If you look at the Arabic language, the person who's called the father of grammar is who? Sibawayhi. And Sibawayhi is who? Sibawayhi is a Persian man. Okay? Today, if you think of hadith, who's the first person that you think of? Who comes to mind? Al-Imam al-Bukhari, rahimahullah. And Al-Imam al-Bukhari is from Bukhara, Uzbekistan. He's from where? Uzbekistan. So Arabs are actually not the overwhelming majority of people who passed on this knowledge. But this particular place, India, has the greatest significance in this knowledge of hadith. Abdurrahman Yahya al-Muallimi, I went to a place called Hyderabad, Deccan. Hyderabad, Deccan is where Abdurrahman Yahya al-Muallimi, who is a Yemeni, he stayed in. He stayed in Hyderabad, in a maktaba called Darul Ma'arif al-Uthmaniyya. Till today, it's still the same. It has all the manuscripts, has so many books there. Abdurrahman Yahya al-Muallimi used to sit there, and through his sit there, he wrote many books. He says, rahimahullah, in a muhadara, a lecture which he gave, which he called it ilm al-rijal, he says, وَلَكِنْ فِي الْقَرْنِ الْعَاشِرِ وَهَلُمَّ جَرَّى تَقَاصَرَتِ الْهِمَمِ وَهُجِرَ عِلْمُ الرِّجَالِ فَقَلَّ مَنْ بَقِيَ يَعْتَنِي بِقِرَاءَةِ كُتُبِ الرِّجَالِ أَوْ نَسْقِهَا أَوْ نَشْرِهَا أَمَّا التَّأْلِيفُ فَأَقَلُّ وَأَقَلُّ حتى أيقظ الله الأمة بعلم الحديث وعلم الرجال والفضل في ذلك بعد الله عز وجل للهند وأعظمه لدائرة المعارف كما سيأتي. He says رحمه الله, in this 10th century, he's talking about his time, and so on, the aspiration of the people have reduced from learning this science, علم الرجال. There is little who give importance to this science, learning the chain of narration and the scholars of hadith, little. Or even writing it or spreading it, it's very little, he said. Let alone authorship. فَأَقَلُّ وَأَقَلُّ. Somebody to sit down and author a book in the science. حَتَّى أَيْقَضَ اللَّهُ. Until Allah gave life to. He gave life to who? الْأُمَّةَ لِعِلْمِ الْحَدِيثِ وَعِلْمِ الرِّجَالِ وَالْفَضْلِ فِي ذَلِكَ بَعْدَ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ لِلْهِنْدِ. The people of India. Allah woke them up, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And for them, they're the ones who stood up to look into the books of hadith. ولذلك, one of the things I saw with my eyes, وهي من العجب العجاب. I saw people who read Sahih al-Bukhari like we read Arba'in al-Nawiyya. Every 3 or 2 days they finish Sahih al-Bukhari. They have it next to their pillows. And inshallah ta'ala, I'm going to mention some of their stories. The speed and the fluency of how they read Sahih al-Bukhari without tala'thum, without any hardship, is ajab, fascination. So he said, حَتَّى أَيْقَضَ اللَّهُ الْأُمَّةَ بِعِلْمِ الْحَدِيثِ. This knowledge of hadith and its men and its sciences, these people of India, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He awoken this science through them. The same is the statement of Fadilatul Ustad Muhammad Abdul Aziz Al-Khawli. He has a kitab called Miftah Al-Sunnah. And he mentions, وَلَا يُوجَدُ فِي شُعُوبِ الْإِسْلَامِيَةِ عَلَى كَثْرَتِهَا وَاخْتِلَافِ أَجْنَاسِهَا مَنْ وَفَّى الْحَدِيثَ قِصْطَهُ مِنَ الْعِنَايَةِ فِي هَذَا الْعَصْرِ مِثْلَ إِخْوَانِنَا مُسْلِمِي الْهِنْدِ أولئك الذين وجد بينهم حفاظ للسنة ودارسون لها على نحو ما كان تدرس في القرن الثالث حرية في الفهم ونظر في الأسانيد. He says that you won't find in the Muslim population today a people in their large amount and in their essence who give importance to علم الحديث as it deserves to be given مثل إخواننا مسلمي الهند, the way our brothers in India have, the way that they have given time and effort to it. أولئك الذين وجد بينهم حفاظ للسنة. You find till today people who've memorized كتب الستة بأسانيدها with its shades, who know it from the top of their head. ودارسون لها على نحو ما كان تدرس في القرن الثالث, who teach it like it was taught in the third generation. حرية في الفهم, their understanding and their pondering on the book is amazing. ونظر في الأسانيد, and the way they look at the chain of narration. الشيخ رشيد رضا. الشيخ رشيد رضا is who? He's the man who woke Shaykh al-Islam of our time, Muhammad Nasiruddin al-Albani, rahimahullah, who gave him the desire to want to know ilm al-hadith. He saw it from this man, Shaykh Rashid Rida. He used to have a majalah that Albani used to read, and from that, Albani liked the knowledge of hadith. He said, وَلَوْلَا عِنَايَةُ إِخْوَانِنَا عُلَمَاءِ الْهِنْدِ بِعُلُومِ الْحَدِيثِ فِي هَذَا الْعَصْرِ لَقُضِيَ عَلَيْهَا بِالزَّوَالِ مِنْ أَمْصَارِ الشَّرْقِ. If it wasn't for our brothers from India, the love and the passion that they gave to knowledge of hadith at this particular time, لَقُضِيَ عَلَيْهَا بِالزَّوَالِ مِنْ أَمْصَارِ الشَّرْقِ, then the science of hadith would have perished. That would have gone. Shaykh Rashid Rida is saying this. Taqiyuddin al-Hilali, al-Maghribi, rahimahullah, Taqiyuddin al-Hilali traveled to who? He traveled to India as well. And he sat there and he took knowledge from the scholars of India. And they said that Taqiyuddin al-Hilali would speak the English language, he would speak the Arabic language, and he spoke Urdu. He studied it. الشيخ تقي الدين الهلالي, he said, ليس القصد أن نذكر في هذا المقام جميع علماء السلفيين الحنفاء من أهل الهند, فإن عددهم لله الحمد أكثر من أن يحصى, ومن جال في أرض الهند الواسع من كراسي من كراشي what's it called? كراشي ومومباي غربا إلى آخر بنغال شرقا, ومن جبال هملايا شمالا إلى آخر مدراس ونواحيها جنوبا, يجد هؤلاء العلماء الأبرار في كل سقرة وتحت كل نجم, ويجد جماعة أهل الحديث حنفاء. Anywhere you travel, he said, go to Karachi, go to Mumbai, go to Hyderabad, go to what you call it, travel through India. Every single place that you go, you will find the people of hadith present. What would you find? Every one of them is there. What are they doing? Preserving, observing, looking. ولذلك one of the things that shocked me was I went to Mubarakafur. I went to where? Mubarakafur. And when I went there, I met Sheikh Abdul Rahman ibn Ubaidullah. Sheikh Abdul Rahman ibn Ubaidullah al-Rahmani al-Mubarakafuri. His father is Ubaidullah. His father, Ubaidullah al-Rahmani al-Mubarakafuri, is the sharih and explainer of the kitab Mishkat al-Masabih. He explained it. And Abdul Rahman ibn Ubaidullah, his father is from one of the four people Sheikh Nasir rahimahullah said, I never saw anyone more knowledgeable than them. Who are the four people Sheikh Albani said? The first one is Sheikh Abdulaziz ibn Baz. The second one is Muhammad al-Amin al-Shanqiyati. The third one is Muhammad Taqiyuddin al-Hilali, who I mentioned. Muhammad Taqiyuddin al-Hilali. And the third one is who? His father, Ubaidullah al-Rahmani al-Mubarakafuri. I went to his house, and every week he reads Bukhari, finishes it. His mutala'a is of Bukhari, Muslim, Abi Dawood, Tirmidhi, Ibn Majah, Nasa'i, Muwatta, Malik, Sunan al-Darimi. Anyone who comes to his house and looks at it, his house is not worth more than $300, everything that's in it. And you look at the whole house that he lives in. So the passion and the love and the drive that they have for ilm al-hadith, la shakka, anyone who goes to that land will see it. Books that are not taught in no other places except you find it taught there, as we would study what? Arba'in al-Nawawi, 40 hadith of al-Imam al-Nawawi. Another thing that I wanted to mention as a muqaddimah before I go into the benefits is al-ijazatul hadithiyah. Having chain for hadith and taking a chain from yourself to the Prophet, is it something that one should do? Na'am. It's something that we should give a lot of importance to. Al-Imam al-Bukhari and Muslim both narrated, and this is the word, this is the chain of Bukhari. Hisham ibn Urwa narrated from his father, Urwa ibn Zubayrin, who narrated from Abdullah ibn Amr ibn As. And I want you to remember the chain, which is Hisham ibn Urwa narrated from Urwa ibn Zubayr, who narrated from who? Abdullah ibn Amr ibn As. That the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَقْبِضُ الْعِلْمَ انْتِزَاعًا يَنْتَزِعُهُ مِنَ الْعِبَادِ وَلَكِنْ يَقْبِضُ الْعِلْمَ بِقَبْضِ الْعُلَمَاءِ حَتَّى إِذَا لَمْ يُبْقِي عَالِمًا اتَّخَذَ النَّاسُ رُؤُوسًا جُهَالًا فَسُئِلُوا فَأَفْتَوْا بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ فَضَلُّوا وَأَضَلُّوا. This hadith is famous. It's the hadith which the Prophet said, Allah does not take knowledge from the people, but He takes knowledge by taking the people of knowledge. حَتَّى إِذَا لَمْ يُبْقِي عَالِمًا, until there's no scholar left on the face of this earth, what happens? اتَّخَذَ النَّاسُ رُؤُوسًا جُهَالًا. The people, they take the ignorance as their what? As their scholars and their reference point. فَسُئِلُوا, then these ignorant ones are asked, فَأَفْتَوْ بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ, they give verdict without no knowledge. فَأَضَلُّوا, they misguide themselves and they misguide others. Pay attention to this hadith. This is the wording of Bukhari and the sanad of Bukhari and Muslim. And Imam al-Bukhari has another ziyadah, another wording. Imam al-Muslim has another word, riwayah, that Bukhari doesn't have. And this wording is Abil Aswad and Urwa, that Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, when Urwa narrated this hadith from Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As, Aisha said to him, فَلَمَّا حَدَثْتُ عَائِشَةَ بِذَلِكَ, when I told Aisha about this hadith, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَقْبِضُ الْعِلْمَ انْتِزَاعًا, Aisha said to him, أَعْظَمَتْ ذَلِكَ. She said, really? Did Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As hear this from the Prophet? So she was reluctant in that regard. قالت, he said to her, she said, أَحَدَّثَكَ أَنَّهُ سَمِعَ النَّبِيَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ يَقُولُ هَذَا. Did he really tell you that the Prophet said this? قال عروة said, نعم, he did. She said, okay. When 1 year went by, next year Hajj, Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she said to Urwa, she said to him, ask him now about the hadith. Abdullah ibn Amr ibn As, ask him. So Urwa ibn Zubayrin, he went and he asked Abdullah ibn Amr ibn As about the hadith. فحدثه, he told him the hadith. He told him the hadith as he had told him the year before, exactly word for word. When he had told him, Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she said, مَا أَحْسِبُهُ إِلَّا قَدْ صَدَقَ أَرَاهُ. The way I see it is that he actually heard this from the Prophet. لَمْ يَزِدْ فِيهِ شَيْئًا وَلَمْ يَنْقُصْ. He did not reduce anything from it, nor did he what? He didn't add anything to it. And then this concept of hadith and looking at the chain and checking things out and verifying things, this is something even our mother Aisha did. And the chain, brothers, is our religion. الْإِسْنَادُ مِنَ الدِّينِ وَلَوْلَ الْإِسْنَادُ لَقَالَ مَنْ شَاءَ مَنْ شَاءَ. If it wasn't for the chain, anyone would have claimed what they would have claimed what they wanted. لَوْلَ الْإِسْنَادُ لَقَالَ مَنْ شَاءَ مَنْ شَاءَ. And it's fascinating because this that I have in my hand right now
is the mud of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to use. This right now, if you hear in the hadith books, mud, huh? When you hear mud, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, hadith Abu Hurairah, Sahih Muslim, Allahumma barik lana fi sa'ina, Allahumma barik lana fi muddina. When the Prophet said, this is the mud that the Prophet used to use, and he would, this would be the scaling for the zakat that he would use it for. Are you with me, brothers? Even the mud has come through a chain. What did it come through? Ha, hufl. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what did Allah say? Inna nahnu nazzalna dhikra wa inna lahu. The sanad for it, Shaykh Ubaidullah, Shaykh Abdurrahman, here's the sanad for the hadith, for the mud. Shaykh Abdurrahman ibn Ubaidullah al-Mubarakafur al-Rahmani. Just to show you that when the Shaykh put the sanad, when he gave me the mud, it brought tears to my eyes, because it shows us this mizdaqu qawlihi ta'ala, the truth of the statement of Allah, inna nahnu nazzalna dhikra wa inna lahu lahafidhun, that we have sent down the Quran and we're going to protect it. If even an Arab is not going to look after it, who's Allah going to make it look after? I'm not an Arab. But the religion will be protected. Mashariq al-ardi wa magharibiha, wherever it may be, it will be protected. The weighing is protected. How do you think a word and a narration will be protected? Let alone the Quran that comes through hadith tawatur. And it has come through multitude narration. وَلِذَلِكَ عَنْ إِمَامُ الشَّافِعِيُّ said, مَثَلُ الَّذِي يَطْلُبُ الْحَدِيثَ بِلَا إِسْنَادٍ كَمَثَلُ حَاطِبِ لَيْلٍ. The one who wants to get a hadith without a chain of narration is like a person who's trying to gather, what is he trying to gather? Twigs and or sticks that he wants to use fire for, but in the night. If you try to pick up sticks at night time, you're most likely going to pick up animal feces and everything. You can't see in dark. وَلِذَلِكَ الْإِمَامُ سُفْيَانَ الثَّوْرِي used to say, الْإِسْنَادُ سِلَاحُ الْمُؤْمِنِ, that the chain is the weapon of the believer. فَإِذَا لَمْ يَكُنْ مَعَهُ سِلَاحٌ فَبِأَيِّ شَيْءٍ يُقَاتِلُ. If you don't have a chain, then what are you going to fight with? That's your weapon. Another thing I wanted to speak about is شَهْوَ الْعُلُوُ الْمُجَرَّدِ. There's this new desire that you find people wanting to have a chain of narration and wanting to take a sanad in a hadith, but they just want to take it as long as it's short. They don't care who they take it from. And this is something that one needs to be very careful, especially when it comes to taking chains. You should try to make sure that you take it from people of the sunnah. ولذلك محمد بن سيرين used to say, إن هذا العلم دين فانظروا عمن تأخذون دينكم. This is a religion. Look how you take your religion from. Don't put into your chain somebody from who? From Ahlul Bidah. So you see somebody travel to the land, and then if the person who he's taken the sanad from is a person of innovation, he would still take it, he doesn't care. When you can find that chain from a person of the sunnah. ولذلك محمد بن سيرين used to say, لم يكونوا يسألون عن الإسناد. At the early generation, they never used to ask about the chain. فلما وقعت الفتنة, when the fitna occurred, من أهل البدع started to come, قالوا سموا لنا رجالكم. They started to tell the people, hey, name your men for us. فينظروا إلى أهل السنة. So they will look at the person, if he's from the أهل السنة, فيؤخذ حديثهم. They will take the hadith. وينظروا إلى أهل البدع. But if the person turns out to be from the people of innovation, فلا يؤخذ حديثهم. Their hadith will be rejected and it wouldn't be taken. ولذلك, if you look at some of the scholars, they would even be called people of the sunnah, or the word Salafi would be used for them because of the fact that the hadith would be taken from them. مثلا هو الإمام علي بن عمر الدارقطني رحمه الله, who died the year 385 هجرية. الإمام الدارقطني said about himself, ما شيء أبغض إلي من علم الكلام. I hate علم الكلام. And I'm not a person who loves to go into innovation and علم الكلام. الإمام الذهبي, he placed a commentary on this, and look what he said. He said, لم يدخل الرجل أبدا في علم الكلام. دارقطني never looked at علم الكلام. ولا الجدال. And he never used to argue with people of innovation. ولا خاض في ذلك. And he never indulged into this matter. بل كان سلفيا. And Imam al-Dhahabi said that, he said, بل كان سلفيا. He was a man of... And Imam al-Dharqutni رحمه الله is who? He's a great Imam in what? Hadith. And Allah bless me subhanahu wa ta'ala in my journey to be with one of the mashayikh and the people of knowledge of India, who graduated from the University of Medina, PhD, and his tahqiq was on the kitab Al-Ilal Al-Warida Lidar Al-Qutni Rahimahullah. Me and him were together everywhere. And some of you, if you watched the video, he's with me, so humble, and he's reading the riwayat and asanid with me through the shuyukhs. But he has the tahqiq on the kitab Al-Ilal Al-Warida by who? Al-Dar Al-Qutni. And when I sat with him and I asked him question about hadith, Wallahi ana ta'ajjabtu ashadd al-ajab. I was amazed with him. I was shocked about his knowledge of ilal and what he knows about hadith. And ilal is a science which is ghamid, very detailed, and it's complicated. Min al-lataif, from the things that are very, mashallah, that stuck out for me was that when I went there, a shaykh who took knowledge from, his name is called Fadlur Rahman al-Madani, who took knowledge from Taqiyuddin al-Hilali, told me that Taqiyuddin al-Hilali, when he came to India, rahimahullah, he said, كان قد هجر الرواية عن شيوخ من أهل البدع. Taqiyuddin al-Hilali, when he came to India, he would ask about the person, is he from the people of the Sunnah or not? If he turned out to be from the people of innovation, he would not take a riwayah from them, even if his chain of narration was very short. وَلَمْ يَرْوِ إِلَّا عَنْ شَيْخَيْنِ السَّلِفِيَيْنِ وَهُمَا. And he told me that two people from the people of the Sunnah, who were Salafis, is who we narrated from. The first one is صاحب تحفة الأحوذي, أبو العلا محمد عبد الرحمن المباركفوري. The author of تحفة الأحوذي, who was Abu al-Ula, Muhammad Abdul Rahman al-Mubarakafuri, he narrated from him. He took it from him. And the second one is, so Abu al-Ula, Muhammad ibn Abdul Rahman al-Mubarakafuri, took from Nadir Hussein al-Dihlawi, Shaykh al-Kulli ful-Kull. He took from him. And between me and, so far, between me and Nadir Hussein al-Dihlawi is Abdul Rahman, who took from his father, Ubaidullah al-Mubarakafuri, who took from Abu al-Ula, Muhammad ibn Abd al-Rahman al-Mubarakfuri, who took from Nadir Hussain al-Dihlawi. There was one sheikh I met, his name was Madhar Hassan al-Azhari, who graduated from Jama'at al-Azhar 1966, he told me. And he has between him and his, between him, if I took from him, it would be him, Madhar, and his sheikh, and Nadir Hussain al-Dihlawi. So I would have two people between Nadir Hussain and him. But now it's longer than that. And he told me he doesn't give sunnah to anyone. And I'll tell you something very fascinating later, inshallah, regarding this story. The second person who he took from, Shaykh Taqiyuddin al-Hilali, was Muhammad ibn Hussein ibn Muhammad al-Ansari, an abihi an jaddi. And his father, who is Hussein ibn Muhammad al-Ansari, is the person who is Haqim ibn Abdul Rahman ibn Hassan ibn Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahab took from, and Sa'ad ibn Hamad ibn Atiq took from. So these are the two people from the Sunnah he took from. ولذلك there's a qissa latifa as well, that Qadi Iyad, his name is Iyad ibn Musa ibn Iyad al-Yahsubi. Qadi Iyad, sahib kitab al-Shifa. He wrote a letter to Muhammad ibn Umar al-Zamakhshari. Qadi Iyad wrote a letter to who? Al-Zamakhshari. Al-Zamakhshari is who? He's a Mu'tazili. Dahabi said about him, كان داعية للاعتزال والبدعة. Zamakhshari was a person who had Aqidatul Mu'tazila, and he used to call to this. So Qadi Iyad wrote a letter to Zamakhshari asking him for all his marwiyat, all of his narrations. And this man, Muhammad ibn Umar al-Zamakhshari, he is a person, ضَعَمَّةُ هَذَا الرَّجُلِ كَثِيرًا. The shortcomings and the mistakes that he has are too much. He has many innovations. And subhanAllah, one of the most shocking things even I found is التَعَرُّضِ لِجَنَبَاتِ النَّبِي صَلَّى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. Even he insulted the Prophet in his tafsir. If you go to قوله تعالى وإنه لذكر لا قوله تعالى وما هو بقول شاعر. When he comes to that ayah, I think it was that ayah, he insults the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. على كل حال قاضي عياد wrote a letter to him asking him for his marwiyat. Zamakhshari refused. What did he do? He refused to give his marwiyat. Qadi Iyad, this is what he said. Al-Mu'arrikh Shihabuddin ibn al-Muqri al-Tilmisani, he mentions in his kitab Azhar al-Riyad fi Akhbar al-Qadi Iyad, he mentions in it, وَسَمِعْتُ غَيْرُ وَاحِدِ بِمَنْ لَقِيتُ يُخْبِرُ أَنَّ الْقَادِ عِيَادَ لَمَّا بَلَغَهُ امْتِنَاعُ زَمَخْشَرِي. When he heard, Qadi Iyad heard that Zamakhshari refused to give him his narrations, what did he say? أَلْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ الَّذِي لَمْ يَجْعَلْ عَلَيَّ يَدًا لِمُبْتَدِعٍ أَوْ فَاسِقٍ أَوْ نَحْوَ هَذَا مِنَ الْعِبَارَاتِ وَاللَّهُ عَلَمْ. Alhamdulillah, praises to Allah that an innovator or a fasiq or somebody like that hasn't got a say over me. Alhamdulillah, he's not in my chain of narration. And this, what I'm trying to say is that a person should not allow the innovators to be from his chain as much as he can avoid it and stay away from it. Now, inshallah ta'ala, that was all muqaddima. I'm now going to go into the benefits that I came across and the things I found very beneficial. The first thing, fa'idatul ula, is وقفة مع هذا القلب. يا إخوة, before you travel, before you try to do anything good, before you want to gain knowledge, have to make sure that you stand with your heart and you question your heart. And you question from your heart two things. Does it have inside it shahwa? And does it have inside it shubha? And if it does, and you find out that it contains any of those two illnesses, that you work to clean it. That you work towards clean it. And subhanAllah, when you travel, brothers, and you go through hardship, you start to realize the hidden defects in your heart that were hiding inside it. And walidhalika Ibn al-Qayyim says in his Nuniyah, he says, وَحْذَرْ كَمَائِنَ نَفْسِكَ اللَّاتِ مَتَى خَرَجَتْ كُسِرَتْ كَسْرَ مُهَانِ. Be careful about the hidden defects that are inside your heart. خَرَجَتْ عَلَيْهِ, will come out. And when does it come out? كَمَائِنُ النَّفْسِ تُخْرَجُ فِي أَوْقَاتِ مِحَنِ. Times of hardship and difficulties, it will start coming out. Are you with me, brothers? You won't see this illness in your heart, and when do you start seeing it? You start seeing it when the difficulties start hitting and problems start to occur, you start to realize it. And when your heart is ill, brothers, all of this traveling and all of this qayd that you're running after and all of this good that you want to achieve, wallahi, you're not going to get it. Al-Imam Sahr ibn Abdullah, when did he say, حَرَامٌ عَلَىٰ قَلْبْ أَنْ يَدْخُلَهُ نُورٌ. Haram is prohibited for knowledge to enter a heart. وَفِيهِ شَيْءٌ مِمَّا يَكْرَهُهُ اللَّهُ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ. And in it is something Allah dislikes. How is Allah going to give to you? How is Allah going to give you, subhanahu wa ta'ala, this light when inside your heart is something which he dislikes? وَلِذَلِكَ I ask you, I remind you all, brothers, when the Prophet ﷺ came out and he was going to call to the message of Islam, what was the first thing Allah commanded him to do? He said, وَثِيَابَكَ فَطَهِّرْ. Purify your heart. وَثِيَابَكَ here means, عَلَىٰ إِحْدَى أَقْوَالِ أَهْلِ الْعِلْمِ, is one of the tafsir of the ayah. What does it mean? A clean your heart. Clean your heart. وَلِذَلِكَ Allah said in the Quran, سَأَصْرِفُ عَنْ آيَاتِيَ الَّذِينَ يَتَكَبَّرُونَ فِي الْأَرْضِ بِغَيْرِ الْحَقِّ. We will divert our verses from the people who are arrogant because they have an illness in their heart. وَلِذَلِكَ سُفْيَانُ بْنُ عُيَيْنَةَ said about this ayah, أي أَحْرِمُهُمْ فَهْمَ الْقُرْآنِ. I will prevent them from understanding the Quran. Muhammad ibn Yusuf al-Thiriyabi, he said, أَمْنَعُ قُلُوبَهُمْ مِنَ التَّدَبُّرِ فِي أَمْرِي. I will prevent their heart from pondering over my command. Ibn al-Hajj in his Kitab al-Madkhal, he says, وَمَعْلُومٌ أَنَّ بَعْضَ الْمُتَكَبِّرِينَ يَحْفَظُ الْقُرْآنِ وَلَكِنَّهُمْ مُنِعُوا فَائِدَتَهُ فِي الْفَهْمِ وَالْعَمَلِ وَذَلِكَ هُوَ الْمَطْلُوبُ. He said, you might find some people who are arrogant, who memorize the Qur'an, but they're not implementing it. وَلِذَلِكَ, pay attention, brothers. Some of you might say, but I've seen somebody who memorized the Qur'an, who know the Qur'an, they know so many ahadiths, how has Allah diverted them from it? The knowledge is three, brothers. What is it? Al-Hifz wal-Amal. The first one is to memorize it. The second one is Al-Fahmu, to understand it. And the third was Al-Intifa'. So they may memorize it. Hatta they may even understand it. But they may not receive Intifa', which is the benefit from it. The second thing that I benefited from my journey is إِنَّ الْفُرْسَةَ إِذَا لَمْ تَنْتَهِزْهَا صَارَتْ غُصَّةً. إِنَّ الْفُرْسَةَ إِذَا لَمْ تَنْتَهِزْهَا صَارَتْ غُصَّةً. The opportunities that come, if you don't benefit from it, it will become a thorn in your neck. You will later be so hurt by the opportunity that missed you. And wallah, I say that because I missed meeting Sheikh Zahiruddin al-Mubarakfur, rahimahullah. And when I went to India, and I went, and I was told that he used to be in this seat, he used to sit here, he used to be here, it hurt me so much. Because he had the shortest chain of narration in Sahih Muslim. He had the A'la al-Isnadi in Sahih Muslim. Then I remember the statement, إِنَّ الْفُرْسَةَ إِذَا لَمْ تَنْتَهِزْهَا. If you do not benefit from the opportunity when it comes, صَارَتْ غُصَّةً. It will be something that you will strangle you in the neck. Like it will hurt you deeply. وَلِذَلِكَ إِبْنُ الْقَيِّمِ رَحِمَهُ اللَّهِ said, يَنْبَغِي لِلْإِسْلَامِ يَنْبَغِي لِلْإِنسَانِ. It is required from the person, أَنْ يَعْرِفَ شَرَفَ زَمَانِهِ, to know the importance of your time. وَقَدَّرَ وَقْتِهِ, and the importance of your time. فَلَا يُضَيِّعُ مِنْهُ لَحْظَةً فِي غَيْرِ قُرْبَةٍ. Don't waste a split second of your time except to get closer to Allah by it. وَيُقَدِّمُ فِي الْأَفْضَلُ فَالْأَفْضَلُ. And do the thing that's best, whether it be a speech or action. Muhammad ibn Abdul Baqi al-Bazzaz, he says, مَا ضَيَّعْتُ صَاعَةً مِنْ عُمْرِي فِي لَهْوٍ أَوْ لَعِبٍ. Muhammad ibn Abdul Baqi, he said, I did not waste a split second of my time with playing around, joking, I didn't. Abu al-Wafa ibn Aqil, who authored the Kitab al-Funun, his book is 800 volumes. He said, إِنِّي لَا يَحِلُّ لِي أَنْ أُضَيَّعَ سَعَةً مِنْ عُمْرِي. It is not permissible for me. And it's not something I should do, wasting my time for anything. Some of the scholars, they were so deep in their time, even when they were eating, they would make sure that they benefit from their time. It was mentioned from Ahmad ibn Sulayman al-Bulqasi, rahimahullah, who died the year 200 and something. يُقْرِئُ الْقِرَاءَةَ فِي حَالِ أَكْلِهِ. The Qur'an, the qira'at would be recited on him, and he would tell the students, read the qira'at on me, وَلَكِنْ فِي حَالِ أَكْلِهِ, when he was eating. خَوْفًا مِنْ ضَيَاعِ وَقْتِهِ فِي غَيْرِهَا. He wouldn't want to waste his time at that particular moment. Ibn Taymiyyah al-Jadd, Ibn Taymiyyah's grandfather, okay, he would what? He would ask somebody to stand outside the toilet. إِذَا دَخَلَ الْخَلَاء لِقَضَاءِ الْحَاجَةِ قَالَ لِبَعْضِ مَنْ حَوْلَهُ اِقْرَأْ فِي هَذَا الْكِتَابِ وَرَفَعَ صَوْتَكَ. He would say, read from this book, raise your voice, I want to hear what you're saying. And he would make somebody stand outside and read so he can benefit from his time. ولذلك ابن هبيرة, he said, وَالْوَقْتُ أَنْفُسُ مَا عُنِيتَ بِحِفْظِهِ وَأَرَاهُ أَسَنَ مَا عَلَيْكَ يَضِيعُ. Time is the most valuable thing, brothers. And it's the thing that is most wasted. ولذلك the poet, he said, مَالِي إِذَا جَذَبْتُهَا صَعَيْتُ أكب... He said, مَالِي إِذَا جَذَبْتُهَا صَعَيْتُ أَكِبَرٌ عَلَانِ أَنْبَيْتُ. He was an old man. He grew old. So what happened was, he started to pull the rope from the well. And he said, مَالِي إِذَا جَذَبْتُهَا صَعَيْتُ. Why is it that when I pull the rope from the well, صَعَيْتُ, I go, ah, why do I make that noise? أَكِبَرٌ عَلَانِ أَنْبَيْتُ. What is it that's heavy on me, that's pushing me down? لَيْتَ وَهَلْ يَنْفَعُ شَيْئًا لَيْتُ. لَيْتَ الشَّبَابَ بُوعَ فَاشْتَرَيْتُ. And he goes, later, if only I was given the time to go back. And then he says to himself, لَيْتَ وَهَلْ يَنْفَعُ شَيْئًا لَيْتُ. Later, but does later benefit you? And then he says, لَيْتَ شَبَابَ بُوعَ فَاشْتَرَيْتُ. I wish that youth, it was something that was bought, I can go to the market and buy it. That's the haqiqah. Now he realizes, because there was a time he was young, he'll just grab the rope, pull it all out, the bucket will come out. Now he's grown old, everything's gone, the efforts, the strength, the ability is gone. And that's the truth, wallahi. You realize, when you grow old, this was going to happen to you. ولذلك the poet also said, تَمَنَّيْتَ أَن تُمْسِيَ فَقِيهًا مُنَاظِرًا بِغَيْرِ عَنَانٍ وَالْجُنُونُ فُنُونُ. تَمَنَّيْتُ, you wish and you want أن تكون فَقِيهًا مُنَاظِرًا. You want to be a faqih, a jurist, who debates, who silences people, who is eloquent in his speech. بِغَيْرِ عَنَاءٍ, without exerting any effort. وَالْجُنُونُ فُنُونُ. And to be insane comes in different ways, in different forms. That's a form of craziness. To be crazy comes in different ways. Because wanting to be a person who's eloquent and mashallah faqih, you saw how Shaykh Khalid al-Mushaykh, when he came, every mas'ala, he'll bring the qawl of who, which imam said it, which book of hadith, everything. But this came through what? I remember the last, I took him to the airport, so me and him were alone in the lift. I asked him, Shaykh, how can a person strengthen his knowledge of fiqh? And he looked at me and he said, bijuhtin. That's it, khalas. You want it? Exert effort. Khalas, that's it. I looked at him and said, sahih, you're right. It's an answer we know, but we think we're going to somehow find something else. Sahih? That's what we want. Al-Imam ibn al-Qayyim, he said, إِضَاعَةُ الْوَقْتِ أَشَدُّ مِنَ الْمَوْتِ. This statement touched me. I got it from his kitab al-fawaid. He said, إِضَاعَةُ الْوَقْتِ, wasting time, brothers, is what? أَشَدُّ مِنَ الْمَوْتِ, is worse than death. لِأَنَّ إِضَاعَةِ الْوَقْتِ تَقْطَعُكَ عَنِ اللَّهِ. Why? Because wasting time and destroying time, it will disconnect you from Allah and the Day of Judgment. But if you die, you're only disconnected from your family and the dunya. Pay attention to that. If you waste time and you forsake time, if anybody's car is blocking another car, please move your car. Barakallahu fiik. An Astra BDO8OVP. Move your car, please. So if you waste your time, it's worse than death. Because wasting time, it disconnects you from Allah on the Day of Judgment. Whereas death disconnects you only from your family and your people. SubhanAllah, when I went to India, I came across Siddiq Hassan Khan, rahimahullah, when he left from Bhopal, where he was from, and he made his way to where? Hajj, rahimahullah. Siddiq Hassan Khan, on his way, he wrote with his own hand, Sarim al-Munki fi al-Raddi ala al-Sukil ibn Abdul Hadi. He wrote it on the boat. There's no flights and planes like that. So he made it by boat. So when he did it, rahimahullah, he wrote it with his hand. And look what he said. He said, وَلَمْ أُضَيِّعْ. He said, I did not waste زَمَنَ رُكُوبِ الْبَحْرَ عَبَثًا. The times I was on the ocean, he said, I didn't even waste a bit. And on the way back, rahimahullah, from Jeddah, Amajiddah, however you want to say it, his way back, what did he write on his hand? He wrote on his hand the kitab, Sunan al-Darimi. He wrote it with his hand, min nuskatin nafistatin ista'araha min al-mirza. He got a good copy of Sunan al-Darimi, and he wrote it. The original copy that he's trying to copy from is not his. There's no printing. Back in those days, if you took a person's book, you'd have to copy it from them and give it back to them. The whole book, you have to write it down, write it. So he benefited from that opportunity, making his own copy of what? Making a copy of Sunan al-Darimi. And this copy of his that he wrote, that he's copying from, is taken from Mirza Amir Biksah, unless I'm saying it wrong, who has the ijazah of Ya'qub al-Dihlawi, rahimahullah. He copied it, and on it is Shah Waliullah al-Dihlawi's ta'liqat on the sides. Which later, when Siddiq Hasan Khan becomes the Amir and he marries the princess, he later copies all of these points. And it's alhamdulillah matbu' mutadawal. He wrote all of that. And look what he said, وَلَمْ أُضَيِّعْ زَمَنَ رُكُوبِ الْبَحْرَ عَبَثًا. I did not waste my time on the ocean a minute. Rahimahullah, rahmatan wasi'ah. Also another thing that I realized, brothers, on my journey is, مَا خَالَطَ النَّاسُ أَحَدْ. If you mix up with people and you're always with people, you will forget the promise that you made with Allah and the covenant that was there. Being with people too much and always hanging around with people, it will make you lose everything. When Allah was speaking about the story of Nabiullah Ibrahim, what did he say? فَلَمَّا اَعْتَزَلَهُمْ وَمَا يَعْبُدُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ وَهَبْنَا لَهُ إِسْحَاقَ وَيَعْقُوبَ وَكُلًّا جَعَلْنَا نَبِيًّا. Nabiullah Ibrahim, he called these people, he called them for so long, when they didn't listen, what did he do? فَلَمَّا اَعْتَزَلَهُمْ. He left them. And he walked away from them. Hanging around with people, always being around people, is something that a person should try to avoid. وَلِذَلِكَ the scholars, they wrote books about al-uzlah. So just leave the people and walk away from them. Nabiullah Musa, look what Allah said about him. وَإِنِّي عُثْتُ بِرَبِّي وَرَبِّكُمْ أَن تَرْجُمُونَ وَإِنْ لَمْ تُؤْمِنُوا لِي فَاعْتَزِلُونَ. I free myself and walk away from you. The scholars, they used to say, وَلِلَّهِ دَرُّ الْقَائِلِ مَا الْعِيشُ إِلَّا الْقُفْلُ وَالْمِفْتَاحُ. Real life is inside a locked room with a key sticking out of it. وَغُرْفَةٌ تُصَفِّقُهَا الْرِيَاحُ. And a room that the wind is blowing through it. لَا صَخْبٌ فِيهَا وَلَا رِيَاحُ وَلَا صِيَاحُ. And there's no noise and there's no nothing. Just you and your room. That's the Aish. Man Aish. What's life except this? A room that's locked. It's got the lock inside it. You're in there by yourself. The wind is blowing through it. All you can hear is the wind. And you're by yourself. Al-Imam Ibn Al-Qayyim, he said, rahimahullah, أطلب قلبك في ثلاثة مواطن. Look for your heart in three places. عند سماع القرآن, when you're listening to the Quran. Look for your heart. Is your heart there? وفي مجالس الذكر. And in the gatherings of knowledge, وفي أوقات الخلوة, in the times when you're alone. He said, فإن لم تجده في هذه المواطن, if you can't find your heart in these three places, فسل الله, ask Allah, أن يمن عليك بقلب فإنه لا قلب لك. Ask Allah to give you a heart, for verily you have no heart. Then in other words, your three places that you should be, أصلاً. Where are they? سماع القرآن, listening to the Quran, وفي مجالس الذكر, وفي أوقات الخلوة. Shu'ayb ibn Harb, he said, دخلت على مالك ابن مغول وهو في داره بالكوفة جالس وحده. Shu'ayb ibn Harb, he said, I entered into a house, مالك ibn مغول was there, and he was alone in his house. فقلت, I said to him, أما تستوحش في هذه الدار. Don't you find loneliness in this room? He's saying this to مالك ibn مغول. أما تستوحش في هذه الدار. Are you not finding loneliness in this room? You're by yourself, nobody's with you. فقال, he said, ما كنت أظن أحدا يستوحش مع الله عز وجل. How can somebody find loneliness when he's with Allah? I'm with Allah. I'm reading the book of Allah. How can I find loneliness? Salim ibn Abdullah, he said, سمعت الفضيل بن عياض رحمه الله يقول, I heard فضيل بن عياض saying, كفى بالله محبا. It's enough for Allah to love you. أما to love Allah. وبالقرآن مؤنسا. And to find a companionship in the Quran. وبالموت واعظا. And death to be a good reminder for you. Then the Quran is your friend. The Sunnah is your friend. ولذلك the poet, he said, اتخذ الله صاحبا وذر الناس جانبا. Take Allah as your friend, close companion, وذر الناس جانبا. And push the people to the side. What? Push that? people to the side. ولذلك جعفر بن عمران الثعلبي he said سمعت السماك سماك say كتب إلينا صاحب لنا a friend of us wrote a letter to us and he wrote إن الحمد لله نحمد الله أما بعد he said فإن الناس كانوا دواء يتداوى به there was a time that the people were cure and they would cure you فأصبحوا داء and today they've become an illness لا يقبل الدواء they don't accept the cure ففر منهم then run away from the people فرارك من الأسد the way that you would run away from a lion واتخذ الله تعالى مؤنسا and take Allah as your friend and your companion والسلام عليكم and he finished the letter إبراهيم النخعي he said to مغيرة بن مقسم he said to him الضبعي he said to him تفقه لان فق ثم اعتزل and then leave the people لان gain فق and then leave the people and then the poet he said أعز مكان في الدنيا سرج سابح وخير جليس في الزمان كتابه The best place to be is a fast horse. بمعنى في الجهاد. وخير جليس and the best thing to sit with is في الزمان كتابه. To be in the gathering, to be in a room by yourself with a book. The best place to be in this dunya is on a fast horse. وخير جليس and the best thing to sit next to and to accompany you is in this timing that we're living in is what? Is a كتاب. Another thing, brothers, And this is true because when I went to Sheikh Abdul Rahman ibn Ubaidullah's house, Al-Allama Abdul Rahman ibn Ubaidullah, I said, Sheikh, you live in this house? Who lives with you? He said, I'm wahdi. He said, I live alone. I said, Sheikh, so what about who helps you on anything? And Allah, he said, Inna Allah ma'ana. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with us. And he's very old. And subhanAllah, I said, Sheikh, did you meet the ulama of your time? Who did you meet? He said, Sheikh Albani was my teacher in the Jami' Islamiyah. I said, Mashallah, how is your alaqa with him? He said, one day in the classroom, I was sitting and he called me, Sheikh Albani called me. And he said to him, are you married? He said, Na'am, I'm married. So Sheikh Albani, under the table, he said, he brought out his kitab, Ahdab al-Zifaf. And he gave it to me, he said, read this book, so you can be a good husband. And then he said to me, do you know how to pray properly? And I said, I studied it with my father. He said, take Sifa Salatul Nabi, so you can learn it according to the Sunnah. I said, who else did you meet? He said, Muhammad ibn Shaqiqi was my teacher. I said, MashaAllah, what did you benefit from him? He said, one day he was in the classroom and he was teaching us and Malik Faisal came in. Muhammad ibn Shaqiqi was teaching and who came in? Malik Faisal came in. And as Muhammad ibn Shaqiqi was teaching, Malik Faisal came in, he told him, sit down. Sit down, listen to the dars. And he carried on his dars. And then Allah Muhammad ibn Shaqiqi, he talked about the rights that the people have on the leader and the leader has on the people. And the responsibilities that are on him and that he should fulfill. When he finished his dars, he said to Malik Faisal, you're now allowed to leave. Now you're allowed to go. And Malik Faisal sat down attentively and he listened to Al-Alama Muhammad, Al-Amin al-Shanqiyatiyu, Rahimahullah. I said, Sheikh, if there's one thing that you could say that you took from all of these ulama that you met, what was the thing that stuck out for you? What was it? He said, Ikhlasuhum. How sincere each and every one of them were. Ibn Baz, Muhammad Amir Shanqirti, Muhammad Nasir al-Din, all of those which I met, he said it was sincere for this deen. This was what they believed in. And it was sincere for it. Al-Fa'idah ya ikhwah. Another fa'idah is, لا يستنكف على الاستقامة ممن دونهم. These scholars, what I saw in them is, if I was to say something to them, they would listen to me attentively. And some of them, wallahi, when I told them things, they brought their pens and their papers out and they wrote it. Al-Abd al-Da'if. But they weren't arrogant to benefit whatever they had. And this is something, wallahi, you could say, it just increases your love and your respect for these scholars. Sa'id ibn Jubayr, he said, لا يزال الرجل عالما. A person remains a scholar, and he will forever be a scholar. ما تعلم, as long as he carries on learning. فإذا ترك التعلم, when he leaves off seeking knowledge and learning, وظن أنه استغنى, and he thinks that he has attained knowledge and he's gained knowledge, واكتفى بما عنده, and he's pleased with what he has, فهو أجهل ما يكون. He's the most ignorant of people. ولذلك والله, one of the قصص that Sheikh Abdul Rahman told me was that he said, I saw Albani sit in the درس of Muhammad Amin Shaqiqi. وعليكم السلام. He said, I saw العلامة الباني رحمه الله in حرم المدني sit in the midst of the درس of Muhammad Amin Shaqiqi and take notes. He said, I saw that happen. He sat down and he took notes رحمه الله. ولذلك the poet he says وليس العمى طول السؤال وإنما blindness is not the one who asks وإنما rather what it is تمام العمى طول السكوت على الجهل. It's the one who is silent upon ignorance for so long. الحميدي عبد الله بن زبير الشيخ البخاري وتلميذ الإمام الشافعي, he said صحبت الشافعية من مكة. I befriended الإمام الشافعي from مكة إلى مصر to Egypt. فكنت أستفيد منه. I was benefiting from him. المسائل I was benefiting from so many things. وكان يستفيد مني الحديث. And he would benefit hadith from me. In other words, he would take it from me. أحمد بن حنبل, he said, قال لنا الشافعي. Ahmed is a student. Shafi'i is the teacher. He said, Shafi'i said to us, أنتم أعلم بالحديث مني. You know the hadith of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم more than me. فإذا صح عندكم الحديث فقولوا لنا حتى آخذ به. You guys know the hadith more than I do. So فقولوا لنا, say to us, حتى آخذ به. Tell me the hadith, so I'll take it from you. هذا إمام الشافعي. وأبلغ من ذلك كله. Something bigger than all of that is نبي الله محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم قراءة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم على أبي. The Prophet reading on Ubay, and he said to him, أمرني الله, Ubay, Allah commanded me أن أقرأ عليك. The Prophet said to Ubay, Allah commanded me to read on you. Read what on you? لم يكن الذين كفروا من أهل الكتاب. Allah told me, read on Ubay. And the scholars, they took from this, ألا يمتنع الفاضل من الأخذ عن المفضول. قاعدة. The scholars took from this, is that the person who is high in station and high in rank, he should not prevent himself from taking from somebody who's lower than you. You might take from them what you know. And this is something that you see from those ulama, that they took from each other. They took from each other. Next benefit that I took from Ikhwani is that if a person lives and takes knowledge on, wallahi, they're going to see faqr and ju', poverty and hunger. All of these ulama, none of them did we see them living in a lavish life. Their life and their qut was very simple. And their lifestyle was very easy, brothers. And subhanAllah, today you look at the people in the UK and you look at how they're running around trying to get money and everything. And one of the things that shocked me is, brothers, you have a 9-to-5 job, you get money in your account, you got so much money, savers account and etc. Do you know that all that can take away from you the hunger is a dry bread? The poet, he says, وَالْجُوعُ يُطْرَدُ بِالرَّغِيفِ الْيَابِسِ فَعَلَامَ تَقْتُلُ حَسْرَتِي وَوَسَاوِسِي. Poverty and hunger can be simply removed with a dry bread. That's all that it needs. لذلك, I was reading the tarjama when I was there in Jama' Salafiyya Manaris, that Al-Qadi Abdul Wahhab al-Baghdadi, who's the author of the Kitab al-Nadair, and he has another, he's a Maliki scholar. He has a book in Qawaid al-Fiqhiyya. And he also has another book called Al-Talqin fi al-Fiqh al-Maliki, that he left Baghdad. He packed his bags and he left Baghdad. 200 people came with him to leave Baghdad. And he turned around and he looked at the people of Baghdad and he said, Ya Ahl Baghdad, the people of Baghdad, I would have stayed with you if only you can give me a bread every day. No one can give me a bread. The reason I'm leaving is I can't. I don't have food. I have nothing to eat. Ya Ahl Baghdad. And so it seems like those 200 people that were walking him towards out of the outskirts of Baghdad were people who were like him. Students from knowledge, who they themselves didn't have anything. So he said, if I can get a bread or something to eat, I would have stayed, but I can't. وَلِذَلِكَ the poet, he said, وَعَلَمْ بِأَنَّ الْعِلْمَ لَيْسَ يَنَالُهُ. Remember that knowledge will not be gained by a person whose aspiration is مَنْ هَمُّهُ فِي مَطْعَمٍ أَوْ مَلْبَسٍ. A person whose aspiration is what? Food, clothing, you won't gain knowledge. فَحْرِسْ لِتَبْلُغَ فِيهِ حَظًا وَافِرًا. Strive to gain a great portion in knowledge. وَهْجُرْ لَهُ طِيبَ الْمَنَامِ وَغَلِّسِ. And leave off the good sleeps that you wanted, leave it off for knowledge. And wake up early morning. If you're thinking about what am I going to eat later, what I enjoy, knowledge is not for you. ولذلك الإمام الشافعي said, لا يطلب هذا العلم أحد بالمال وعزة النفس فيفلح ولكن من طلبه بذلة النفس وضيق العيش وحرمة العلم أفلح. شافعي said, no one seeks knowledge to gain money and to be honorable. He will never succeed in that. But the person who seeks knowledge with humiliation and having a hard life and honoring knowledge, that person will succeed in gaining knowledge. Hakada. But is that like a food? All you need from it is what? As the Prophet ﷺ said, مَا مَلَا آدَمٌ وِعَاءٍ شَرَّ. That the slave does not fill a utensil worse than his own stomach. That's the worst thing to fill. بِحَسْبِ مِبْلُ آدَمٍ. Enough for the human being is what? أُكَلَاتٌ يُقِبْنَ صُلْبَهُ. All that you need from food is that which will make your back straight. It's really what you need from food. Like, and for us, it's what? Cars, etc. However, a person becomes faqir. These scholars in India and those which I met, however, they never asked anything. And they had the izzatun nafs. With all of that which qalilul yad, whatever they had, they were honorable. They didn't ask anyone and they didn't want anything from anyone. وَلِذَلِكَ سُفْيَانَ ibn Uyayna, he said, كُنْتُ قَدْ أُوتِيتُ فَهْمَ الْقُرْآنِ. I was given the understanding of the Qur'an. فَلَمَّا قَبِلْتُ السُّرَّةِ. When I accepted the surah is what? The gift from the leader. من أبي جعفر. أبي جعفر المنصور, when he gave me the gift, the money. سُلِبْتُ. Allah took the understanding of the Qur'an and the sunnah from me. When I accepted the money, my understanding of the Qur'an went. Meaning I should have done this genuinely for whose sake? Allah. That's what he said, Rahimahullah. Also the thing that I benefited was the tawadu of the ulama and the humility of these people and how humble they were. Every time we went to a place, they would not let you stand up and do anything. They will serve you where you are. Wallahi. وَلِذَلِكَ الشيخ صالح بن عبد الله بن حمد العصيمي, he mentions in his rihla of Hind a story of عبد الجبار الغرنوي رحمه الله. عبد الجبار الغرنوي, he came to where? He came to Delhi, New Delhi. And he wanted to go to Nadir Hussain al-Dihlawi. Nadir Hussain al-Dihlawi is Nadir Hussain al-Dihlawi. Sayyid al-Humam. They call him Shaykh al-Kulli fil-Kull. So when he came to the train station that the British built, and he got there, an old man was waiting for him, and he said to him, he saw his appearance, and he walked towards him, and when he walked towards him, he said to him, "Hey, who are you?" And he said, "I'm a man, and I want to go to the masjid by Nadir Hussain al-Dihlawi. I came there to him." The old man said to him, "Okay, give me your stuff." He took all the stuff and he put it in his back, and when he put it all his back, he took it to the masjid for him, and he walked out. So when he came, he put all his stuff, he was so excited, he went to the masjid and he said, "Where's Nadir Hussain al-Dihlawi, Sayyid al-Humam? I want to meet him." They said, "He was the man who was carrying your stuff. The man who carried all of that on you for you and brought it to the masjid is him, Nadir Hussain al-Dihlawi, if you're looking for him." So the man cried and he ran back, and when he reached the Shaykh, and he grabbed him and he said to him, "Shaykh, hafidhak Allah, why did you do this?" And he said that the Prophet ﷺ said, "Man kana yu'minu billahi wal yawmil akhir, falyukrim dayfa." You know the hadith in 40. That one of you is not a true believer unless he honors his what? Unless he honors his guest. Another thing, brothers, that I benefited there is ni'matul tawheed, the blessings of at-tawheed. I never saw any place shirk has reached the qimma, the pinnacle of that place. The shirk there is too much. The Hindus and what they worship. They worship the rats. They worship cows. They worship just about everything. And it's ajeeb. A taxi driver is driving a car and he's got on the car a god. And the god keeps falling from the dashboard, from the floor. And on the bottom it says made in China. He doesn't recognize to say, "What is this God that I'm worshipping?" Allah says in the Quran, "Alladhina amanu wa lam yalbisu imanahum bidhulmin ulaika lahum al-amnu wa hum muhtadun." Darkness is on their face. They worship the cow, so it's banned to eat cow meat over there. You can't have cow milk, you can't touch it. So they drink the urine of the camel cow. They make houses out of the cow's feces. They honor it. They have to destroy it in a way where you have to burn it and etc. The cow doesn't know. He's looking at you confused. Thinking, "What are they doing to me?" And they're worshipping it. يُقَدِّرُونَهُ وَيَحْتَرِمُونَهُ. So you come to realize, brothers, what? نِعْمَةُ التَّوْحِيدِ. And that this aql Allah has given you and how you ponder, how you think is مِنْ نِعْمَةِ اللَّهِ تَبَارَكُ وَتَعَالَى. Allah bless you. The other benefit that I benefited, الصَّبْرُ فِي طَلَبِ الْعِلْمِ. The way that we have knowledge preserved, looked after. Some of these scholars, subhanAllah, they had to write their books, the Bukhari and Muslim and Muwatta and all of that with their own hands. SubhanAllah, I went to Jami' Salafiyya Banaris. This Jami' Salafiyya is a big markaz. This is where Sheikh Wasiullah Abbas came out from. This is where Sheikh Ubaidullah al-Rahmani visited. And this was a place where Sheikh Rabi' ibn Hadi al-Madkhali used to teach here. He taught there. So I went there and I stayed overnight, and in the morning I would go And so there's a room they give you inside the place. Wallahi, they honored us. May Allah honor them for dunya wal akhirah. Wallahi, karama, ya ikhwa, dayafa, guests, qimma, pinnacle. We came, we drove to Banaras. We came to the Jami'ah Salafiyah. When we came in, they gave us a room. In the room, there's a little maktab, books. So I read some of the books in there. And in the morning, they allowed me, they said, inshallah, we're going to open for you the maktaba, the general library, so you can read what you want. So what happened was, when I went to the room and I stayed, in the morning I woke up, I came to the Jami'ah Salafiyah Maktaba, the big one, the general one. When I came, I think it's 9 floors, if I'm not wrong, and it's full of books. Books, a lot of things that are there. It's the biggest book, it's the biggest maktaba owned by Jam'iyat Ahl Hadith. It's the biggest maktaba Ahl Hadith have in India, as I was informed. This maktab, I was told, every single book in that maktab was read by Al-Allama Ra'is Al-Nadwi, rahimahullah. And it was a story that Shaykh Ubaidur Rahman, Muhammad ibn Hanif Al-Madani, rahimahullah, told me, was that, he said, that's his Shaykh, Shaykh Ra'is Al-Nadwi is his Shaykh. He told me that Shaykh Ra'is Al-Nadwi one night spent in the library, in his bedroom, in Jami' Al-Salafiyya Banaras. He was in his bedroom and he was reading, and he was writing, and he was authoring a book. And that whole night he had his head in the book. When he was writing, he came running out of his room, Al-Allama Ra'is Nadwi. He came running out of his room with his pajamas on. And he came to the first guy that he grabbed and he said to him, Salaam Alaikum, what's my name? The man said, he was shocked. He said, what's my name? In other words, Shaykh Al-Allama Ra'is Nadwi, his mind got so deep into the book and the knowledge, he forgot his name. So he kept saying to the man, what's my name? And he said, what do you want it for? He said, I need to write it at the end of the book I'm writing. And then he said to me. So he told him his name and he went back and he wrote his name. As-sabr fi talab al-ilm. How patient they were. Sa'at, ayyam. Some of them nights they were spent in their room. وَلِذَلِكَ when Allah came to the ayah, when he came to the ayah, وَاصْبِرْ نَفْسَكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ رَبَّهُمْ بِالْغَدَاةِ وَالْعَشِيِّ يُرِيدُونَ وَجْهَهُ يَحْيَى بْنُ أَبِي كَثِيرٍ. He said, هِيَ مَجَالِسُ فِقْه. هِيَ مَجَالِسُ فِقْه. He said, this, وَاصْبِرْ نَفْسَكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ أُمُّ مُحَمَّدٍ. Be patient with the people of righteousness. He said, it's the gathering of fiqh. Be patient there. Be patient there. يَحْمِلَ بِكَثِيرٍ. He said, لَا يُسْتَطَاعُ الْعِلْمُ بِرَاحَةِ الْجِسْمِ. That knowledge cannot be attained with a body that's relaxed. And what's shocking is that Imam Muslim brought this where in his? In Kitab al-Salah, Kitab al-Muwaqid, right? Bab al-Muwaqid al-Salah. Question is, why did Imam Muslim bring the kalam of يَحْمِلَ بِكَثِيرٍ, which is لَا يُسْتَطَاعُ الْعِلْمُ بِرَاحَةِ الْجِسْمِ وَبِرَاحَةِ الْجَسَدِ. Why did he bring? What was the context in Kitab al-Salah? What's it got to do with that? Muslim brought this after he brought all of the chains of the riwayat of the hadith that he was speaking about. And it was so much different turuq and different riwayat that Muslim was trying to say to the people, you could not get this with a relaxed body. Nah, I put so much effort in this. And I put too much hard work in this. Al-Imam al-Asma'i, he said, مَنْ لَمْ يَحْتَمِلْ ذُلَّ التَّعَلُّمِ سَعَةً بَقِيَ فِي ذُلِّ الْجَهْلِ أَبَدًا. Anyone who does not endure the hardship and the humiliation of seeking knowledge, he will remain, he would be forced to endure the pain of ignorance. You choose. Are you going to accept the hardship of seeking knowledge, or are you going to choose the hardship of what? Being ignorant for the rest of your life. وَلِذَلِكَ the poet, he said, مَنْ لَمْ يَرْكَ الْمَصَاعِبَ لَمْ يَلِلِ الرَّغَائِبَ. Anyone who doesn't endure and take on the hardship, he will not attain the ease. وَلِذَلِكَ I'm going to conclude with a story, because there's more to say, but I'm going to conclude with a story of a man that he used to have a shop. And he used to sell. And at night time, he would collect, all day he made money, and at night time, what would he do? He would calculate the amount of money that he made the whole day. Sahih? The whole night he would count the money. So one of his employees that was working for him would do what? He would sleep in front of the shop. He was very poor. He would work for him, so he wouldn't waste his time going elsewhere or somewhere else. He would just sleep right in front of the shop. He'll get himself one bread, he'll eat it, and he will sleep under the shop. So this man, in the shop, all day he's working, and all night he's calculating what? So he saw this guy sleeping under the shop. He said, why are you sleeping here? He said, oh, I sleep here, I just get a bread, I sleep here, and in the morning, I come to work. And so he's trying to count the money, and this guy is snoring, so he's giving him a hard time. So he put the money down, And he thought to himself for a bit. He said, I'm all day working, and all night I'm calculating the money I made. And I'm not even relaxing with the money that I'm making. And this man works for me, and he works a simple life. And he's snoring in front of my shop. And in the morning he's going to come into the shop and work. And he's relaxed. He's got no problem. So he walked away from everything. So dunya, even humiliation comes from it. In order to get something, what do you need, brothers? You would also need to humiliate yourself. Why would you do that for knowledge? Why wouldn't you do that for knowledge? And Allah did not will, subhanahu wa ta'ala, for us to go through. I just wanted to say one last point, inshallah ta'ala. Come, how much we have for salah? Yeah? Malagari, thank you. Allah, okay, we'll stop there, inshallah ta'ala. Anything which I have said that was wrong is from me, shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanakallahumma bihamdika, ashhadu an la ilaha illa Allah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.